Help us to be faithful friends then. But not only that, Lord God, help us to be faithful brothers, working faithfully and dutifully for our elder brother. Lord, what an awesome thought that the perfect Son of God who came call us brothers because we belong to you. Speak to us through your word because we are listening and we want to hear the word because we worship you in spirit. We want to worship you now in truth. Thy word is truth. We are waiting expectantly, O God. Hide the ones who preach behind the cross. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Once again, we continue in our series of messages on what faith does. From Hebrews chapter 11. Today we're going to be looking at the seventh feature of faith, of what faith does. So far we've learned that faith listens to God, faith walks with God, faith fears God, faith obeys God, faith receives from God, and faith submits to God, as we dealt with Esau last week. Today we're going to look at how faith worships in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 21. The writer of Hebrews says, "By faith Jacob, as he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, and worshiped, leaning on the top of his staff." Notice the word worship. On his deathbed, Jacob worshiped God, leaning on his staff. What an amazing picture of someone who's come to the end of their lives, looking back and die with the last word on their mind that he gives me the victory. Here's a man who can hardly walk. He needed a cane. He needed a walking stick to keep him on his feet. He can't lift his hand in the air and praise the Lord, because if he did, he would have stumbled over. The only strength he had was as he leaned on that staff, bowed his head, and worshiped the God who has been so good to him. It wasn't all that way with Joseph. With Jacob, you know. Now, when we think of Jacob, there are other stories from his life that sticks out that, you know, could be the highlights of his life. For instance, we know that he wrestled with God. He literally wrestled with God. And at the end of the night, he was a fighter. That the God had to say, "Let me go." And Jacob said, "I will not let you go until you bless me." He was always after a blessing. What about you? Jacob was always seeking a blessing. But what the writer mentions here is a nondescript story that happened at the end of Jacob's life. The story is about him blessing his grandsons while leaning on his staff. And the amazing thing is, it is not about him blessing them and saying, "You're going to be your life and your line is going to come from your life, and your line is going to come Jesus Christ." Not like Jacob's dad Isaac, when he was given a blessing. So here we see Jacob blessing Jacob's son, Joseph's sons. And we wonder why he would specifically bless his sons. Because remember, Joseph was his favorite son. Folks, you better be careful who you make favorite in your family. Favoritism is an awesome and awful thing among family members. You have people hating one another because they know that I didn't count and you were the best. Mom and dad think you were the pea in their soup. And I was, whatever you want to call it, slouching around. So here we see Jacob blessing Joseph's son, but Jesus was not born from that line. Why was he blessing? He wasn't blessing them with the blessing of the firstborn. Something else is going on. You see, Jesus was born in the tribe of Judah, not Joseph. So we see then that this story is not about an old man worshiping and blessing his grandson because he thinks they're going to carry on in the line. He was just blessing them because by faith, it says, he recognized that things must have been bad, but it's not that bad. Look at me now. Blessing my grandson, whose father I thought was dead for years. So we see then that worship comes out of faith. You can't worship God unless you believe. That's one of the reasons when I see people running up and down the aisle and shouting and screaming, and I said, what do you believe? What do you believe? Why are you running up and down the aisles and shouting? That's not worship. Worship takes place sometime in the most awkward of places and circumstances. You know that. Do you remember Jacob's story? After he stole the blessing from Esau. Remember what happened? He had to run for his life. His mother found out that Esau was planning to kill Jacob when their daddy dies. Because he recognized that Jacob had not only tricked him out of his birthright, but had stole his blessing. So Jacob fled to Uncle Laban. And when he got to Uncle Laban's house, he noticed that Uncle Laban has two daughters. But the little one was a looker, the youngest. Jacob fell in love with her. Her name was Rachel. And so he decided to ask for a hand in marriage, but Uncle Laban said, you got to work 7 years to gain her hand. So he did, joyfully. But when the day came for the wedding to take place, Uncle Laban was just as tricky as Jacob was. And he tricked Jacob. I don't know how that happened, people. You got to watch what's under the veil. Got to lift it up and make sure you know what's under there before you say, I do. But Jacob didn't. He was so anxious. 7 years of waiting, see? But Uncle Laban had switched the girls. And instead of Rachel, he got Leah. And the Bible says Leah was slow in the eyes. You know what that means, don't you? She wasn't a looker. You know. This deception was just like what Jacob had done to his father Isaac. God taught Jacob through his deception to hate the sin of deception. He experienced how painful deception was. This is also teaching us that how we deal with people is very important. How we deal with people. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 18, 25 to 26, to the faithful, you show yourself faithful. To the blameless, you show yourself blameless. To the pure, you show yourself pure. But to the crooked, you show yourself shrewd or astute. God said, you think you can trick people? Let me show you how trick work. And this you can see in Jacob's case. The deceiver was deceived. Jacob got the taste of his own medicine and he didn't like it. And so that's how he came to hate his own sin. Jesus taught this principle in when he said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 2, Matthew 7, 2, "For in the way you judge, you will be judged, and by your standard of measure, it will be measured to you." And then in verse 12, he says, "Therefore, however you count, you want people to treat you, so treat them, for this is the law and the prophet." In other words, this is the Bible. So God brought Jacob to repentance by paying him back with his own trickery. What he did to Isaac, Laban did to him. So Jacob hated deception as much as he had loved it and wallowed in it. So after 7 years of additional work, he got to marry Rachel, his favorite girl. But unfortunately, his home was not a happy home. What are you doing with two wives anyway? You got enough problem with one, don't you? His home was not a very happy home. Leah, the Bible said God saw that she wasn't loved, and he made Leah fruitful, and boy, was she ever fruitful. She had 5 sons: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun. And all those time, poor Rachel didn't have any. Years later, though, with praying and God answering their prayer, Rachel conceived and Joseph was born. And because Joseph was the son of the favorite wife, his father loved him. He even made him a fancy coat. Dress him up, looking like a peacock. And that's what he felt like. Because he goes around strutting around, showing off his fancy coat. And then he begin to tell him about a dream he's having. Telling his brother, you know, "See my fancy coat? One of these days you're going to bow before me." That didn't draw any love for him, did it? And his brother hated his guts. Why? Because his father make it so obvious he was the favorite. Don't ever do that to your children, people. So one day, Jacob sent Joseph to look up his brothers who were pasturing their sheep some distance away. And the brother saw him coming and said, here's our chance. Let's see him predicting, bowing before him. And as they decided to kill him. Fortunately for Joseph, a bunch of slave traders were going by and they sold him into slavery and forgot all about him. Then they killed a male goat. They must have torn it too. Joseph caught into the blood and brought it to their father. And in Genesis chapter 37, verse 32, listen to the contempt in their voice. "We found this. Please examine it to see whether it's your son's coat or not." It's almost like, good riddance. So now we see that Jacob's uncle tricked Jacob, and now his sons tricked him, which is one of the most painful of all. You very children tricking you. So in verse 33 of Genesis chapter 37, Jacob said in his response to them showing him the coat, "It is my son's tunic. A wild beast has devoured him. Joseph has surely been torn apart." So the Bible said he tore his clothes and he put on sackcloth on his loins, and he mourned for his sons many days. And when the Bible says many days, it means many days, months possibly. It was the saddest time in the life of the family. Verse 35 says, of 37, "Then all the sons and all his daughters," you always thought Jacob only had one daughter, didn't you? A lot of daughters. If he had 12 sons, you can believe that he has double the daughters, right? He had his sons and his daughters rose to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. And he said, surely I will go down to the grave in mourning for my son. So his father wept for him. In other words, Jacob was saying, I'm going to my grave in misery. Have you ever said that? People have said that. I'm going to my grave disappointed in you. Awful thing to say. He said, I will mourn for the rest of my life. There's nothing to give me joy anymore, he said. I have nothing to look forward to. My favorite son is dead. Jacob, you got 11 other boys and your daughters. No, I am going to go to my grave mourning. Loss of Joseph caused Jacob to lose his joy in everything. And he lived like that. A frustrated old man waiting to die. However, Joseph was alive. And as you know, because we know the rest of the story, don't we? He was prospering in Egypt. God had blessed him. He had become a powerful man in Egypt. Sometime later, there was a famine coming in the land, and God had given the hint to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh had a dream. And Joseph was able to interpret the dream, and Pharaoh elevated Joseph to the second in command of Egypt. And David made preparations for the 7 years of famine that was coming. And the famine was widespread. It got to Canaan. But in Egypt, there was warehouses of food. The famine extended into Canaan, so Jacob sent his sons to buy some grain in Egypt. And when they got there, they did not realize that the big man in charge was none other than their brother whom they had sold into slavery. So when Joseph revealed himself to them, they were terrified. Can you imagine that? I'm surprised they didn't have heart attacks. Maybe that wasn't so prevalent back then. Didn't have so much worries about it. But Joseph was a generous, God-fearing man. He knew how to forgive. And he forgave them. And he said to them, go and bring my father down to me. And they did. Can you imagine now when the brothers return home? I can imagine the conversation. What are we going to tell Dad? We're going to have to fess up. So they went home and they confessed to Jacob what they had done. But you can imagine the shock of poor Jacob. He was shocked. And when they told him, he didn't believe it. Genesis 45:26 says, and they told him, saying, Joseph is still alive, and indeed he is the ruler over the land of Egypt. I wonder if they said to him, and you remember that dream? We had to bow down. But he was stunned. And the Bible said he did not believe it. Would you? Do you blame him? For years he'd been mourning for this boy. In verse 28 he says, then Israel said, it is enough, my son Joseph is still alive. I will go and see him before I die. Come on, Joseph. I mean, Jacob, is that all you got to say? You're going to go see him and then die? He said, my son is alive, but it's too late for me now, so I just go see him and then I just lie down and die because I've wasted all these years in mourning. So I just see him. And then I'm done. Now, you'd expect when Joseph saw, Jacob saw Joseph, he'd hug him and, oh, there'd be a party. And he's saying, you know, verse 29 and 46 says, Joseph fell on his neck and wept on his neck a long time. And then Israel says, now let me die, since I've seen your face that you are still alive. Really, Dad? Really? You want to die now? How about talking about how we're going to go for a ride and how we're going to make up time, the rest of the time that God has given us? You're going to die. That was the word. Those were the words of a miserable old man who says, now let me die. Sounds like Jacob had been so lost in mourning, he wanted to die. But praise God, God had other things for him. God wasn't finished with him yet. In verse 20, in Genesis 47, 28, we read, Jacob lived in the land of Egypt 17 years. Isn't it interesting? He came wanting to die. Now that I've seen my son, let me just lie down and die. He lived 17 years afterward. And those 17 years changed Jacob. We know this because Jacob gave two descriptions of his life. He gave one when he first got to Egypt and a different one 17 years later when he leaned on his staff and worship. When he first entered Egypt, he told Pharaoh in Genesis 47, 9, he said, the years of my sojourn are 130 years. There are few and evil have been the years of my life. Nor have I attained the years that my fathers have lived during the days of their sojourning. What he's saying? He said, my few years have been bitter. Compared with my dad and my grandfather, it's just a few years. And they've been miserable. When Pharaoh asked Jacob how old he was, Pharaoh said, how old are you? He said, 130 years. Yet, 130 years. But that's not much in comparison to my father and my grandfather. I haven't even come close to them. And when I look back over my life, Pharaoh, I think I have to say it's been evil. Isn't that sad? Some of us, we get older and we look back and we're thinking, boy, what we wasted our lives. And we go out, and you know what that can do to you? That can kill you. As I look back, I wish I had done more with my life, he's saying. And some of us are saying, I wish I had done more. I wish I had given. Do you know somebody like that? Are you like that? We don't see a lot of faith there, and there's certainly no worship. We don't see him say, thank God, God has been faithful. I lived to 130 years. Now they've been miserable, and I've suffered, and I've struggled. But thank God that's not the end of Jacob's story. So if you find yourself in a place of regret today, it don't have to be the end of your story either. Jacob changed during those 17 years in Egypt, and his fledgling faith came to life again. And Hebrews 11 says, when faith is revived, worship is revived. Some of us don't go to church because our faith is dead. But when our faith gets revived, we want to seek out God's people. So where there's faith, there will be worship. Listen to him in Genesis chapter 48, verse 15 and 16. He said, the God before whom my father Abraham and Isaac walked, the God who have been my shepherd all my life to this day, the angel who have redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads, and may my name live on in them. Interesting, isn't it? Jacob came to Egypt thinking he was a failure, saying, my years have been few and evil. But 17 years later, he looks back at his life And he recognized that God had been his shepherd. And he says, I can now see God's hand every step of my life. I made some mistake. I messed up. But when I look back over my life, and when I think it over, what the song says, I can truly say that I've been blessed. Hallelujah. Because I can testify to the goodness of God. I can see that God has been my shepherd all my life. He has redeemed me from all evil. Evil has not defined my life. I refuse to let evil get me. And he worshiped. He worshiped. What about you, my friends? You feel like Jacob? As you look back over your life, do you have a lot of regrets? And do you think the years have flown by so quickly? Are you saying, I wish I had made some better choices in my life? This then is the story for you then. This story is ideal for you. If you're looking back over your life and say, man, I made a mess of it. This story is for you. God ain't done with you yet. He has great things in store, but you gotta give him your life. Joseph made the journey from regret to worship, and so can you. Jacob did it by the faith, and so can you. But how did Jacob move from regret to worship? How did he make the transition? What happened? Two things. First of all, Jacob worshiped because he knew that God has been good to him. He knew that he was forgiven. He knew he was forgiven. Verse 21 of Hebrews 11 says, by faith, Jacob, as he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons, worshiping, leaning on the top of his staff. This is a beautiful picture of a man looking back over his life, remembering how he deceived his father, how his uncle Laban deceived him, and how his son did the same thing to him. But he said, but by the grace of God, I did not fall up and die. I'm here. And when I look back over my life, I realized that I made some mistakes. I made some bummers. But God forgave me, and God has blessed me. Old sins have a way of catching up with us, especially as you grow older, isn't it? I don't know about you. When we were young, I didn't think about sin. Didn't even hear the word too often. Now that I'm older, I'm thinking about it all the time. Amen. So here you are, leaning on your stick, or sitting in your favorite chair, or lying in bed at night, can't sleep, even though you're counting sheep, or cows, or goats, whichever is your favorite. And you think to yourself, well, why did I do that? Why was I so silly? How come I let myself be duped? People, that's in the past. And you ask yourself, what was I thinking of? But the Bible said Jacob worshiped at the end of his life. There is only one way that someone whose life has been filled with regrets can worship, and that is if they know that they have been forgiven. You know that you've made your peace with Almighty God. Jacob bowed and worshiped because he knew that God had dealt with his sins. As he looked back over his life, he sees how God had been with him every step of the way, and that God had blessed him. When he looked at how many kids, children he had, now he has a big shot son in Egypt. He saw how God's love shielded and protected him all his life. What about you? When you look back over your life, what do you see? Do you see those footprints of God bearing you up sometimes? Well, Jacob's journey can be yours. Listen to the promise of God and listen to his condition, because God's promises are conditional. Listen to this one. 1 John 1:9. You all know it. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Notice, we have to do something. What do we have to do? We have to confess our sins. Don't go tell God I made a little mistake. No, I am a sinner in need of forgiveness, God. I need Jesus. Just saying God forgives, so I'm okay. You ever hear people say that? I was talking to a friend not so long ago, and I said, you know, you really need to come to know Jesus Christ. Confessing your sins. The person said to me, well, I pray every night, you know. And I do ask God to forgive me every once in a while, yeah. I said, that's not what it's about. It's confessing that you're a sinner. It's believing in your heart that Jesus Christ is your Savior. And believing in your heart, you confess with the mouth, Jesus Christ is Lord, and your life will be changed. We must confess. You must admit to God you are a sinner in need of forgiveness. You need to ask God. You know why? Because confession brings freedom. When you confess your sins and you've been cleansed by God, you don't have to go out to bed at night and every time you draw, you wake up trying to figure out, I wonder if I'm okay. No, if you truly confess, if you've repented and confessed, the Bible says he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This promise is hard to believe, but it's because it's so good. You don't have to jump hoops. You don't have to say 10 Hail Mary and 5 Our Fathers. You simply bowed your head in confession and you asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart and life. You see, when faith, remember what faith is. Faith believes in what God has revealed and what God has promised. Right? We trust what God has promised. He promised to give you eternal life. You've got to trust God for that. How do you get it? If you confess your sins, receive Jesus Christ as Lord, and then he cleanses you from all unrighteousness. He gathered up all your sins and he fold them up and he threw them in the garbage bin to be incinerated, because he don't trust you. You might come in there digging up again. So he incinerates them. And he will not hold it against you anymore. Faith believes what God has revealed and trusts what God has promised. Secondly, Jacob worshiped because he believed in God's promises. What was God's promise to Jacob? Remember, he had the blessing from Isaac. And the blessing was, I'm going to take you to a land where I'm going to bless you. And out of that, you become a blessing to all nations. He believed that. Joseph's sons were a crown prince in Egypt, right? When Jacob came to Egypt, he was a refugee. What he got to be blessing to his grandsons with? Huh? What did he have? He came as a refugee. Famine was in the land. Ravaged everything he had. Jacob had to send a wagon to pick him up. He didn't have anything when he went to Egypt. So how could he be blessing these two boys? What Jacob had was the promise of God that he was going to inherit a land. So when Joseph heard his father was sick, the Bible says he took his two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, and to see the old man before he dies. In chapter 48, verse 1 tells us that very plainly. In verse 5, Jacob says to Joseph, "And now your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt, before I came to you in Egypt, they are mine. Ephraim and Manasseh shall be mine, just like how Reuben and Simeon and Judah and the boys are mine, so are your two sons." Jacob adopted Joseph's two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, and they became heads of tribes that had their names. So the son of Reuben became Reubenites. The son of Simeon became Simeonites. The sons of Levi became Levites. But the sons of Joseph didn't become Josephites. They became their own tribes, heads of their own tribes, because they were sons of Jacob with a direct share in God's promise. Years later, they entered the promised land, and it was divided into 12 regions, one for each of the 12 tribes. Now, if you look at the map of the promised land, you will notice that Levi didn't get no land because they were specifically chosen by God to be the ministers and to be the ones who lead the rest of the family in worship. They took upon themselves the responsibility of being the pastors and deacons and whatever else that they called themselves back then. So they didn't inherit the land, but Joseph's two boys. It's interesting because Joseph is the firstborn of Rachel. And the firstborn boy of the family back then get a double portion of the father's legacy. He gets a double portion of his mother's legacy now, right? Jacob said to Joseph, "Ephraim and Manasseh are mine." So instead of Joseph receiving one piece of land, his two sons receive what? Two pieces of land. When Jacob adopted Joseph's sons, he made them a beneficiary of the promise of his God. Why? Why would he do that? Jacob knew that those boys were well set in Egypt. There were princes in Egypt. He knew that. But he wanted them to know that you may be a prince in Egypt, but you belong to God's people in a land that God's promised. So don't go sit down over here and call yourself Egyptian, because you're not. They belong to another land. So they may prosper in Egypt, but they need to know up here that this is not my home. God did that for you when you come to know Christ. They need to know that they belong to God. They're the people of God. We don't belong to these pagans. I may be prince over there, make my money over here, but this is not my home. So Jacob says, "You boys are heirs of God's promise. Your destiny is in another land, a land you have never seen, but you have to believe it in faith." Jacob gave these boys a share in the promise of God. Do you realize that's what God has done for you in Jesus Christ? It points to the fact that Gentiles are now fellow heirs with Jesus and with the Jews. We are now members of the same body, and we partake of the same promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel, the good news. We live our lives in this world as Ephraim and Manasseh lived in Egypt, But God has given us through Jesus Christ an inheritance which can never fade or spoil, is kept in heaven for you. Don't get too stuck on this world. It's not your home. You're heaven bound. Unshackle yourselves of the things of this world and keep your eye on Jesus. Some of us are running down stocks in the stock markets all over the world. Well, guess what? It crashed a couple of weeks ago. Some of you are grunting. You're not telling me the truth because you lost some money. But you want to have stocks? Get yourself a load of heavenly stocks. Put your stock in heaven. Bible said it's kept in heaven. Jacob showed up in Egypt full of regret. He ended his life leaning on his walking stick and praising God. What a picture. That journey from regret to worship has been set for us to know that it is possible for you as an individual, and it's possible for me today. You can also make Jesus the center of your life, because in him we have an inheritance that don't perish, that don't fade, that rust and moth can't eat, that cannot be devalued. Get yourself some heavenly stock, because the Lord God himself is looking for people such as you who learn to worship him in spirit and in truth. May God Almighty help you this morning, that you'll recognize wherever stage of life you are, it ain't over yet, because God ain't finished with me yet. You can be a worshiper like Jacob, in spite of having a hard life, in spite of being battered in this world. You can still at the end of your life come to God and says, you've been good to me. You've never failed me. Circumstances try to knock me out, but every time they knock me down, you gave me the strength to stand up. And Lord, I remember that time when I couldn't make it, and you lift me up and you carried me and you set my feet and a steady place, that rock called Jesus. Blessed are you, O God, because you've done an amazing thing in my life. Don't you go messing with, I have a rough life. Touch somebody's life. Stop thinking about you. You're called for a purpose. Touch somebody's life, because God wants to touch you, but you need to experience forgiveness from God. And you need to, once you have experienced forgiveness, you need to learn to forgive. You need to wash that man right out of your hair. You need to wash that woman right out of your hair, whoever it was that messed you up. And you need to say, you will not hold me earthbound, because I'm a child of God. And this is not my home. I'm heaven bound. Amen. May God bless you and cause you to wake up and see your possibilities and your potential, that you are God's child and you cannot fail. Father, we thank you again that when we call ourselves the children of God, we know how to worship. So we worship you, because you seek those who knows how to worship in spirit and in truth. So we worship you this morning. We thank you for the life of Jacob. So many things we have looked on before and we thought, But Lord, we thank you for teaching us the lesson that we may wipe out, but you have never allowed us to wipe out, to slide away. You are always reaching out to us. Reach out to somebody this morning. May someone for the first time said, yes, I need the forgiveness of Almighty God. And God, to the best of my ability, I repent, I turn away from, and I turn towards you. Jesus, I welcome you into my life this morning. And I ask you to guide me through this rough territory and to keep me in your purpose and your grace and your mercy, so that I too will be strong for somebody else who need to hear, Jesus loved me, this I know. So we confess our sins. We ask for you for mercy and for your forgiveness, O Lord. And we turn to the Christ from Calvary, who came and showed us the way. And we want to be obedient to your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. 634. 634. God will take care of you. He's been doing it. I hope you have recognized it. Standing as we sing. Be not dismayed, whatever me time. Father, we believe that. We're not just singing words. Engrave them on our hearts that you will take care of us individually as well as collectively. You provide, you sustain. you care for, and you lift up. So Lord, in all of our deportment, we pray today that you'll be active. Someone needs the strength. Someone needs courage, Lord. As they look at the path they're on, they see nothing but mysteries and darkness. But you're a God of light. Shed light along the way. And help us to recognize that you don't give us all the light. You give us as much to sustain us in the exact quantity we need. Help us to recognize that's the way you work. The Bible says it's while we are in the way, while we are carrying on, that you do come to guide and take care of us. Someone needs you to take care of them physically today. Some it's emotionally, some it's mentally, some it's financially, some is relationally. But you said you'd provide all our needs. So we believe that. Because you're a God who have never broken a promise. Because you're faithful. So we're relying upon you this week to straighten out our pathway and guide us with your eyes through this week coming up. Whatever comes our way, O Lord, we want to commit it to you even before they get here. And we want to thank you beforehand for what you're going to do, how you're going to give us the victory. We thank you for the victory that we will experience this week. And so, Lord, guide us. And if it comes to the point where we're not here physically, because we don't know when the call may come for us to exit to our homeland, may we do so joyfully, rejoicing in the Lord. May we be able to lean on our support, whether it's our staff, whether it's a walker, whatever it is, whether it's a family member we need to lean on, give them the strength to keep us up as you encourage us along the way. We ask you to bless our people. Walk with us this week. Give us the due power that we need to be an overcomer. And when the enemy comes, can you remind us to give him his marching orders in the name of Jesus? To remember what Jesus said, "Get thee behind me, Satan. You have nothing to do in this life, because this is a committed life to Almighty God." So give us the courage this week. Give us the faith to walk faithfully through it. Now, Lord, as we separate one from another, will you bless each one that walks through the door? Will you guide each one who are listening in? And will you bring us together again safely, rejoicing because of what you're going to do in our lives this week? Honor yourself among us then, O Lord. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, may God go with you, enabling you to be more than conquerors, because you are the children of God. Amen. And amen.